The next speaker, Pema Gyamcho, is the Director General of the International Center for Integrated Mountain Development, and he has a deep sense of loyalty and commitment to the Himalayan mountains for the 8 regional member countries, Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, China, India, Myanmar, Nepal, and Pakistan. Please, Pema Gyamcho, the floor is yours.
Can you see my screen? No.
Yes, we see it. It's up. Yeah. Try again.
Can you see it? Hello?
Yes, we can see it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I would say that Walter has made my life easier, so I will not go through the background so much. I come from Bhutan, and I am from a village right in the interior of Bhutan, around close to 3,000 meters. So I'm living most of the experiences that everyone is mentioning, and I have come here to Isimor again after about 12 years. Now, I worked here around the same time as Walter, and then I went back to Bhutan and became an accidental politician for a while. But my heart is with the mountains here, and so I have come back. So Isimor, I think those of you, Walter has already mentioned, we have 8 member countries, and it runs right across from Afghanistan through to Myanmar. So I will not mention that. Already Walter and several others have already mentioned, but important thing is the HKH, the Hindu Kush Himalayan region, is home to about 10 major Asian rivers. And more than, as Walter mentioned, more than quarter of the world's population depends on the ecosystem services or blessings from the Hindu Kush Himalayan mountains. This is a geographical picture of the Hindu Kush Himalayan region. This, I think, clearly depicts the elevated area of this region. Now, the Hindu Kush Himalayan is not as simple as a homogeneous ecosystem, but this is only in the eastern Himalayas. You can see the diversity of forest, the vegetation, and so on, right from the alpine kind of vegetation, which has shrublands and meadows, rhododendron, dwarf, conifer species. Then we go down right to the subtropical forest, and even similar forests like the rainforest. And of course, I think everyone knows that eastern Himalayas are very, very vulnerable to climate change. And I think Walter has already touched upon this. I will not spend time on it, but this is the overarching the impact of climate change in the Hindu Kush Himalayan region, as well as in other mountain areas: the accelerated climate change, rapid melting of glaciers, enlargement of glacier lakes, and then, of course, causing disasters, mainly in the form of floods. So floods account for 1/3 of the disasters occurring in the region. And of course, women are much more susceptible to these natural disasters. Of course, it has also impacted the livelihoods of people in terms of affecting agriculture productivity, destroying infrastructure, and also leading to the overexploitation of niche species that grow only in the Himalayan mountains, like the cordyceps that you see. And of course, now with COVID-19 pandemic, things have really changed for the worst, and about 20 to 30% of people dependent on tourism and other small and micro enterprises were badly affected by this pandemic. Of course, not everything is from our own making. I think the rapid melting of the glaciers and ice and snow are also to do with the fog, the smoke coming up from the adjacent plain areas. As you can see, the whole area is covered with the haze that comes from the industrial areas, from the wildfires, and also the agriculture debris burning in the plains. Now, I think we have thought about the mountains being the abode of gods and deities and spirits. Now, we all know that the mountain peaks are known by the name of deities, you know, like Sakarmata or Chomolungma or Jomolhari. So all of them have actually names that relate to local deities and, you know, spirits and so on. But are we respecting them? This is the traffic jam in Mount Everest. If it is a palace, if it is an abode of God, then I think we should not be, you know, trampling on it. And this, how long we can sustain this, I don't know. But definitely we are not treating it as a sanctified place. You know, it's now become also a garbage dump, you know, with tourists, mountaineers going up. Increasingly, you see these mountains of waste, mountains of garbage. And I think Deepak Ji has already mentioned about the dams, the destructive, the destruction that it causes to lives, livelihoods, and ecosystems, and you know, hydropower dams in all our rivers. And perhaps we need to, you know, rethink that. Now, what does this mean for the species? You know, iconic species like the snow leopard. Are they going to be extinct? Because their, you know, habitat is being pushed to the limit, what you call to the vertical cliff. As global warming increases and the habitats, you know, the snow line recedes, so does the habitat for snow leopards shrink. And further down in the water, either due to floods or due to the, you know, the low volume of water flowing in the rivers, it also threatens native fish species like this golden mushroom in Bhutan. So I learned that the rivers actually dry from bottom up. You know, they come from the mountains, drain into the sea, but if they lose energy along the way, they die, you know, from the bottom up. But I think the killing takes place on the top. Now, here I may relate to, you know, in Bhutan, mountaineering is banned. You know, most of the high mountains in Bhutan are not yet climbed, and that is because, you know, in Bhutan, it is still considered sacred places, and there is a royal decree from the king banning mountaineering. So I think at least there is some hope, some good examples in the region. Now, Walter, as well as Deepak, has touched on the importance of water. And I fully agree with Walter that in the short term, the quantity of water is not going to be a problem. The problem is going to be, no, when we need water, they won't be available. Where we need them, they won't be available. Now, if you can see here, and as already mentioned, most of the springs are drying up across the region. You know, 30 to 60% of the springs are reported to have dried up, and also the water flow in the rivers are, you know, becoming very seasonal, and also changing and becoming less and less during the dry season. Now, I don't know whether you can see this slide, but this is on the top of a mountain in Bhutan near a monastery. There is an, you know, a desperate request for visitors to come with water for offering at the altar. So even the deities are desperate now. And then the towns, the cities are thirsty for water. I think in many parts of our region, many cities, as much as you know, close to 50% of the population lack access to clean drinking water. And of course, then the irrigation system, drought is increasing, and you know, particularly irrigation is also suffering. That also affects food security. Now, I think here we bring science, philosophy, and practice, you know, together. Now, climate change. Maybe directly not in our control, but there are so many things that we can do ourselves in the region. Forest fire, for example, is a major cause of pollution. The air quality is badly affected. This winter season, 2020 and 2021, around 54,000 forest fires are reported across the region. The annual change through deforestation, logging is, you know, in some countries, reported to be as high as, you know, 27%, minus 27%. And then, as already mentioned again by Deepak, the Dorset terror. Now, this has become a very popular political instrument. Having been in politics myself, I know how popular farm roads or rural roads, and everybody just goes with road construction, but not in a proper way, haphazard way, and then that is leading to fragmentation of habitats, lots of habitats, and on top of that, the poaching is also going on in several places. The question is, will you have tigers, or will our future generations see tigers? If you look at the Himalayan iconography, there are four power animals: the tiger, the mountain lion, the dragon, and the Garuda. Actually, the three of these have already disappeared. The tiger is still remaining, but maybe in course of time, we'll see tigers only in paintings. Now, if you can read what this picture says, things are not always what they see. The deer isn't crossing the road. The road is crossing the forest. So that gives a powerful message. Now, one of the reasons is, again, within our control, how we use our land. The land use changes have deeply affected the ecosystem services. If you look at the plateau, Tibetan plateau, you look at the wetlands and the rangelands up there, in many cases, even in Bhutan as well as in Nepal, the wetlands have been converted to agricultural land or for building infrastructure. And that is, of course, affecting the groundwater recharge and so on, and as well as the carbon storage. And also in the high altitude rangelands, some traditional livestock species like yaks and sheep, people have converted to Kashmir goats, and they are much more destructive in terms of their grazing habitat. And then, of course, in the meat fields, we have also changed the system, perhaps, without too much consideration of the long-term impacts. We have changed what you call the fallow cultivation system to permanent cultivated areas, wrongly termed as shifting cultivation, which is actually not. So when in a particular field is cultivated after 14, 15 years, we are now cultivating it every year, and that is also causing. The use of organic, from organic change to use of chemical fertilizers and pesticides, of course, that is contaminating our water bodies, and also animal draft power to farm mechanization has its own impact. And from subsistence economy to a market economy, which means we are losing a lot of diversity. From a diversity of crops to monocrops, monoculture crops like potatoes, which require a lot of external inputs. Well, I don't dare to say recommendations, but is first of all to follow this philosophy through this message of the four harmonious friends, the elephant, the monkey, the hare, and the bird. The bird passes the food to the hare, and the hare to the monkey, and then to the elephant, and then the seed is dropped with the dung by the elephant and nourishes the tree. So this is the meaning of this picture here. So we need to recognize nature's need for protection and coexistence. We need to recognize the collective public interest, including that of our future generations. We need to recognize the collective responsibility, as already mentioned by previous speakers, that it is the responsibility of both individuals and nations. We need to respect and value traditional knowledge and beliefs, and recognize the need of indigenous communities. We need to honor and uphold the highest standard of environmental and social safeguards set through mutually agreed norms. And then we need to, I think this is the key point, we have technologies, we have innovations, we have also institutions, and also in many cases we have appropriate policies and legislations, but they are not screened through an ethical lands. So I think ethical validation of any technology that we introduce would be necessary as we go forward. We need to strengthen the upstream downstream linkages and do more in terms of instituting polluter pay system and payment for environmental services, and of course strengthen cooperation at all levels. To conclude, let me just say what we are doing from ECMO. We are trying to promote cooperation at local, national, regional, and international levels. We are trying to adopt a transboundary and transregional river basin-based approach that Walter also alluded to earlier. And we are trying to institute mechanisms for bringing our scientists, policymakers, practitioners together at various forums. And we have to work hard to also enhance financing mechanism. Finally, I would like to leave you with this message. Thank you. If you can read this, this is a peculiar animal in Bhutan called the takins. I think some of you may have visited. So there is a road passing through this takin territory, and they are saying they can reach home comfortable and easy. But how are we supposed to reach ours? This is a cartoon from the Bhutanese national newspaper, and I think that conveys the message for us today. Thank you very much. Over to you.